Bonsoir, monsieur.
Bonsoir, madame.
Combien coûte le cidre là-bas?
Celle-ci?
Oui, oui.
5 francs.
Oh, c'est trop cher. Bonsoir, monsieur.
Bonsoir, madame.
Enfin, ma belle!
Let go of me! How dare you, you brute! Let go of me!
Well, you can get away this time, huh?
She's English.
Let go of me!
What's she doing here?
Stealing!
It's a lie! Take it
down!
Oh! How dare you touch me? I can buy thousands of bottles of your filthy wine. I'll show you who I am.
Ah, I didn't recognize you. Forgive me, me lady.
My lady's right, you pig! I...
Oh, c'est awful! Qu'est-ce que vous me faites?
Here, dearie. It'll do you good.
Thank you, dear. You've all been very kind. I didn't mean to get you into trouble.
No trouble at all. Always wanted to kick that swine in the pants anyhow. And I'm glad I done it. I'm English, too. My name's Smith. Mary Smith. What's yours, dearie?
Emma.
Emma? I knew a girl whose name was Emma. Emily Burroughs. What's yours?
My name? My name is Emma, Lady Hamilton.
Oh, that's what I mean. Serves me right. I shouldn't be so nosy. Well, darling, if you don't want to tell me your name, I'd be the last one to put my nose into anybody's secret. I remember my mother telling me that Lady Hamilton was the most beautiful woman in the world.
Have you got a mirror?
Yes. Better you didn't, dearie. Oh, well.
I know it. I know that face. For 10 years, it has looked back at me from different mirrors. It must be me. But I always wait for the miracle. That one time, just once more, when it will be another face that looks at me again. A face I knew before. But that face must be dead.
Go on. Tell us all about it. Doesn't matter if it's true or not.
True or not. I don't know it myself. So long ago, I don't know it anymore. My life really began when I was 18. I was beautiful then.
Folks from London!
One day I arrived in Naples at the palace of His Excellency, the British Ambassador.
How's London, Gavin?
Your Excellency.
How's my nephew? Did he send everything?
It's all here, Your Excellency.
Splendid. Hey, get me a hammer. It's just...
Mr. Greville sends his respects.
Don't bother me about Mr. Greville now.
He
a hammer and a chisel. Come on, quick.
It's most important, sir.
Exquisite.
Come and look at this.
Enchanting. Whose work is it?
George Rumley.
If he could paint reality, he would be a master.
Isn't that reality?
The ideal an artist dreams of. No woman ever lived with such coloring, such godlike simplicity.
I thought so too till I met her.
You've met her?
In London last year. And if you're patient, you may see her in Naples one day.
Your Excellency.
Oh, not now, Gavin. I'm busy. I'll see you presently.
But I must tell you.
Very well, if you must, but tell me quickly.
Yeah.
Mum! Mum! Look, it's lovely. It's a real palace. Oh, I do hope Sir William will like us.
Don't you worry, darling. Of course he'll like you.
And remember, I'll do all the talking. Charlie told me exactly what to answer to everything.
Well, why on earth didn't you tell me? Where are they?
Here he comes.
You must forgive me. It's disgraceful. I had no idea you'd come. How do you do, Miss...
Emma Hart, if it pleases your Excellency.
Of course, my dear. How could I forget?
This is my mother, Your Excellency.
Welcome to Naples, madam. This is my friend, the French ambassador. Did you stay in Rome?
Yes, Your Excellency, and thought it very beautiful. We saw the Colosseum by moonlight and were deeply impressed with the Vatican.
We just missed the Pope by 10 minutes.
That was a great pity, madam.
Did you come through Pisa? Did you see the famous Leaning Tower?
Yes, Your Excellency, and we thought it very beautiful. We thought the Leaning Tower of Pisa one of the most remarkable and lovely phenomena in the whole of Europe.
A chimney went like that in Liverpool last year. You remember, Emma, the soapworks. It leant right over the gin warehouse, and the bishop said it was the finger of God.
Charles, Mr. Greville sent you many kind wishes, Your Excellency. And he hopes that I will prove worthy of your kindness and speak good French and Italian when he comes to take me home in October. He is coming the first week in October. And he sent his uncle a kiss.
Well, that's the first present I've ever received from Charles Greville. Well, I feel sure you must be tired after your journey, madam. Francis, show the ladies their rooms. Au revoir, madam. Au revoir, Miss Hart.
Who is she?
Charles Greville found her.
Found her? Oh, where can you find things like that?
Well, Charles happened to find her at Featherstone Castle, you know, Sir Harry's place.
Oh, she's a relation of Sir Harry?
You might call her that. She lived there for a whole hunting season, and a very gay hunting season it was, I'm told.
Oh. And where did Sir Harry find her?
Well, you remember Dr. Graham's Temple of Health and the famous dance of the Seven Veils?
Oh, she's a dancer?
You might call her that. She was quite a success. And the fewer the veils, the greater the success. But alas, the police locked the place just after the last veil fell.
The older I get, the less I seem to know about women.
It's the penalty of your wicked youth, Your Excellency. Don't ask me what happened to her before. It's the usual past, I suppose. A poor little country girl wronged once and then wronged again. The old story. Lower and lower, but always up and up.
And now she's the guest of an ambassador. With a past like that.
Past? Look at this statue. 200 years in a Greek temple, then thrown into the mud by some barbarian soldier. 2,000 years sinking lower and lower into the mud, then dug up by the plough of a peasant. Changing hands every year until at last it comes to its rightful place. Into the hands of someone who understands the glory of its beauty. Because, my friend, it is still beautiful, isn't it? Despite its past. Gavin? I'll dine tonight with Miss Hart, alone, at 8 o'clock.
Yes, Your Excellency.
Thank you, my man. I'll ring for you later if I want you.
Very good, madame.
Two ambassadors, Mum, two! Well, what did you think of me? Wasn't I wonderful?
You're all that, darling, and more.
Well, so far, so good. But please, Mum, not another word about the soap factory, at least not till I've married Charlie. Charlie said Sir William was very fussy about that sort of thing.
Now, don't worry your pretty head about Sir William. Why? You'll have him eating out of your hand within 3 months.
3 months? 3 days. He'll be eating out of it tonight. And in a month, Charlie will be here to take us home. How pleased he'll be with me.
He will indeed, but there's no great hurry. It's very nice here just now, and it's not costing us a farthing.
Oh, it's all very well for you, but what about me? Yes, Your Excellency. No, Your Excellency. Of course, Your Excellency. Oh, how I miss my Charlie.
Yes, he's a likely young fellow. But there's no one good enough for my Emily, though it is her own mother who says so.
But, Mother, I wouldn't exist without Charlie. He's done everything for me, everything. Well, he's made me a lady.
I know, darling, I know. Oh, look at that mountain with the smoke coming out of it. The coachman said it went off a few years ago and killed several people. Now, that sort of thing would never happen in Liverpool.
Oh, Mother, you're hopeless. That's the famous volcano. People come miles to see it. What do they call it? Charles told me 100 times. Smoking Mountain. Vesuvius. That's it, Vesuvius. If Sir William asked you what you think of it, just say it's lovely.
Yes, dear.
It's all mixed up with the history of ancient Rome. Nero set it on fire and then said the Christians did it. Remember, Mother, it's knowing little things like that that makes you a lady. Whenever I have a nice piece of fish, it always makes me think of the sea.
The what?
The sea, Your Excellency.
Oh, yes.
Charles was wonderful about things like that.
About fish?
Oh, you're so funny, Your Excellency.
You know, every time you call me Your Excellency, it adds 1 year to my life.
Sir William?
That's getting better.
Tell me, my dear, was my nephew so positive about coming here?
Oh, absolutely. In fact, he would have brought me here himself if he hadn't been unavoidably detained in London.
Just a second, my dear. As we're to live together under the same roof, I see no reason why we should not be perfectly frank with one another. As much as I hate to spoil this beautiful picture that you've drawn for yourself of my nephew, there's one point that must be made quite clear. Charles Greville will never come to Naples.
But, Your Excellency, Uncle... He definitely promised.
There is a wide gap between my nephew's promises and his fulfillment of them.
Promise he gave me, he will keep.
Your confidence in him is really touching. Did he promise you marriage as well?
Why deny it? It must be written all over me.
I'm afraid I've got to destroy those sweet dreams of yours. My nephew never had the slightest intention of marrying you. Either with my consent or without it.
What did you say, Your Excellency?
I said he's not going to marry you, Emma.
But that's not possible. Why should he send me here with my mother? It costs a lot of money, the journey.
Perhaps he felt you'd be better off with his uncle. A nice vacation.
But I didn't need a vacation. No. There must be something else. And what's to happen after the vacation if he doesn't want to marry me? He's talked of nothing else for years. It was his idea. I never urged him. I was quite happy with him just as it was. Tell me, Your Excellency. But please tell me the truth. Did Charles tell you about me? Do you know about my...
He did. And I imagine that was the only thing he did not lie about. Oh, but please, my dear, I don't want to make you feel ashamed.
Ashamed? Oh, I'm not ashamed. There's nothing to be ashamed of. It's true there were men in my life before Charles. I admit it. I made mistakes. I was young. I was stupid. I believed in men and their promises. But Charles knew about me before he took me into the house, before he promised to marry me. And now I'm different. Not only my clothes, but inside. I'm good. I know I'm good. So why should he lie to me? Why did he send me here? What am I doing here?
Charles had a lot of debts. Did you know that?
Yes, quite a lot, I know.
His debts have been paid to the tune of £5,000. Besides, he has plenty of cash to save him from new debts for a long time.
I see. He sold you antiques, paintings, and among the bric-a-brac, a certain Emma Hart. That wasn't fair. That wasn't gentlemanlike. He shouldn't have done that. He shouldn't have raised me up just to throw me down again like this.
My dear.
Leave me alone. You're just as bad as he is. Well, perhaps you haven't made such a good bargain after all. I'm not going to stay here.
I'm going away now. Now.
Oh, don't take it to heart, my dear. Forget Charles. Forget the old memories. Forget London. I can offer you a new life and a far more exciting one. Naples is a wonderful city. You'll be a success here. You'll like it. Perhaps not today, nor even tomorrow. But you are young, and the young heal quickly. You will learn singing and music under the great masters in Italy. You will speak French and Italian with our finest teachers. Every one of a kind in Europe comes to my house, and you will meet them all. You'll dine with famous soldiers, artists, and statesmen. You can't be presented at court, of course, but you'll have your own villa by the sea and your own coach. You'll have your private box at the opera. Ever since I first saw you in London, I felt this house of mine to be empty, missing its greatest and most lovely ornament. You will be that ornament, my dear. And except for that absurd presentation at court, you will have everything in life that a woman could possibly dream of.
What did you say?
Nothing. Try to sleep. Good night, Emma.
What's wrong, darling?
Oh, Mom! Mom, I'm so miserable. He never wanted to marry me. He got 5,000 pounds from the old man to send me here. He never wanted to marry me.
There, my precious, don't cry, my sweet. Oh, you're too good for any of them. I'm going to pack now. We'll go right back to London, and then you can give that precious Mr. Greville a piece of your mind. Plenty of good men want to marry my Emily. There now, darling, don't cry. Just as good fish in the sea as ever came out of it. There now, my darling, precious Emily, there now.
And I forgot London and the old memories. I was young. I healed quickly. I learned French, Italian, singing and music. And one day I had more than I ever dreamed of. I became his wife, Emma, Lady Hamilton.
La 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 la. My daughter, her ladyship is still asleep. Good morning, Contessa.
Good morning, madame.
My daughter, her ladyship, is still resting. Perhaps you wouldn't mind waiting a little while. How is Her Majesty this morning?
Her cold is very troublesome, madame. Her throat is very sore.
Has it gone out of her nose?
No.
You know, the best way to cure a sore throat is to wrap a woolen sock round your neck at night, going to bed.
Oh?
Good morning. Good morning, Contessa.
Good morning, Your Excellency.
Is Emma still asleep?
She is asleep. In my village, a husband just turns round in bed and looks for himself to know.
Yes, and the Queen of Naples does not wear woolen socks to pin around her throat.
If the Queen of Naples wore a healthy pair of woolen socks, she wouldn't have a sore throat.
What's happened?
I don't know. Maybe the smoking mountain went off again. Let's see.
Come along.
About this, firing salutes at this hour of the morning.
Why shouldn't they blow their cannons off? That's what they've got them for. Boom! Boom!
Good morning, my dear.
Boom! Good morning, William. Here, give it to me.
Let me look, my dear. There's a small boat coming ashore. They'll probably need me. Excuse me, my dear.
Emma?
I'll attend to it later.
Well, here's a nice fat one from London.
Oh? Her Excellency Emma, Lady Hamilton, British Embassy in Naples. Charles Greville, London.
Open it, child, open it.
I think not. Send it back and write on it, unopened, return to sender. Poor Charles. He's exactly 3 years too late. And as far as I'm concerned, he simply doesn't exist.
Are you happy, my child?
Happy? 3 years ago, my only idea of happiness was to be married to Charles Greville. After that, I wanted revenge. Well, I got that in a way, too. Then I wanted to be presented at court. And even that impossible wish was granted to me. I got everything. Everything a woman of the world could possibly wish for. So why shouldn't I be happy? Of course I'm happy, Mother.
Well, Emma, what's good enough for you is good enough for me. And being mother to a ladyship is not to be sneezed at either.
Oh, you silly old thing.
Oh, you're lovely, Emma. You're so beautiful, Emma.
And what about you? Look at you with your little cap and your silver buttons and your beautiful skirt. You're the beautiful one.
Your ladyship, could you spare me a moment, please?
Yes, Gavin, I'm in a great hurry. Goodbye, darling.
It's about the dinner invitations for Sunday night.
Then, of course, His Eminence the Archbishop, the Duchess of Argyle, and if there's no performance, the prima donna of the San Carlo. Then the two ladies from Venice. Which is the deaf one, Gavin?
The Contessa Giovanni.
Oh, we'll put her in Sir William's right. The Marchesa Campiani, the old harpy, and the French ambassador. We'll put him there, between them. Oh, he'll have a nice time.
I beg pardon, my lady, but Sir William informs that the French ambassador cannot be invited for the present.
Why ever not?
Sir William mentioned that... Sir William mentioned there's a difference between the...
William, what's this absurd business about the French ambassador? I need him for the party on Sunday night.
My dear, may I introduce the captain of the Agamemnon?
How do you do? But William, I need him. He's amusing and he's a bachelor, and I need a single man to make my number even look.
Well, I'm sorry, my dear, but I'm afraid we won't be seeing the French ambassador for quite some time.
Why? What's the matter with him?
Well, the captain can explain that, I think. He just brought an important message.
Oh?
We're at war with France.
War? That's torn it. Bang goes the French ambassador. Oh, dear. Well, who can I get to sit between these two dreary old ladies? My dear Captain, we shall be so delighted if you will dine with us on Sunday night. You will sit between the two most amusing and charming ladies in Naples.
No, very kind, Lady Hamilton, but I sail tonight.
Oh, then I gather you must be in a hurry. Don't let me disturb your conference. I'm going.
Well, Captain, you were saying that the Admiral of the Fleet wanted,
Yes, sir. Lord Hood advised me to instruct you. He instructed...
Oh, it's all right, Captain. I have no secrets from Lady Hamilton.
I'm very sorry, Sir William. You must forgive me. I'm not used to discussing matters of this kind in the presence of ladies.
Oh, is it as wicked as all that? Good gracious. I promised to be with the Queen at 12. She won't order a single new dress until I've discussed the patterns with her.
That's a very grave responsibility, my dear.
Goodbye, William.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
We've captured Toulon, but the Admiral needs 10,000 troops to hold it. It would take 3 weeks to bring such a force from England, but from here they should be in Toulon within 2 days. The treaty between England and Naples provides full cooperation in wartime, and the Admiral expects you to secure those troops from the King of Naples without delay.
I'll make out an application for an audience with the king.
Application for an audience? But surely in a matter as urgent as this, we could see the king at once?
At once? I can't just walk into the royal palace.
Well, when will you get the audience?
Friday may be possible. Saturday, almost certain.
Saturday? But Sir William, we must have these troops immediately.
Oh, really, my dear Captain, you must leave this in my hand. You see, I know these people, and you don't. I'll make out the application at once.
That's me, too. Do you like it? It's a Romney. Circe watching her lover sail away.
Is it?
You know, I could get you those troops like that. You were speaking rather loudly, Captain, and the houses over here get so stuffy if you close the doors. You're worried, aren't you? You have an important mission, haven't you? Has it ever occurred to you that women can sometimes be of more help than men?
Not in a matter of this kind, Lady Hamilton.
How do you know? It just happens that I shall be seeing the Queen within the next 10 minutes.
The Queen? This is an important matter of state.
All the more reason to see the Queen. Now I let you into a secret, Captain, which everyone in Europe knows. Except you, Captain. The real King of Naples is the Queen.
Licenziato!
Hai capito? Io per te non so parlare secondo il proprio vecchio e terzo per me non c'è nessuna ragione per mantenere il posto di capo.
Their Majesty is pleased to be with the children this hour, but my orders are to let Milady in any time, even if the princess and princesses pleased to be with their august parents.
Your august family appears to be pretty big.
Yes, the marriage of the august parents is continuously blessed. There are 15 princes and princesses so far. You will see.
I have the honor to be, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, and I'll sign it at once. Ooh. There. Well, here we are, Captain. I'll have this application to the palace in half an hour. I thought it advisable to ask for only 8,000 men. We make it as many as 5.
We asked for 20,000, and we got 10,000. There.
Very much indebted to Lady Hamilton, Sir William. The manner in which she conducted her campaign against the Queen was a masterpiece of strategy.
Well, there, my dear Captain, you see the real ambassador to Naples. At least to the Queen of Naples.
Well, Captain, now that you have your soldiers a week before you might have done, there's no need for you to leave so soon. You can go tomorrow. And we'll have a wonderful party on your ship tonight. I'll bring the Queen, and you can get the King as well if you'll allow him to conduct the ship's orchestra. We'll sail out to Capri. By midnight, we'll be at the Blue Grotto. Capri by moonlight. You have no idea how beautiful the world can be. We'll decorate the ship with flowers. And I'll dance. I expect you've heard of my dances. The dance of the nymph. It will go beautifully with the night on the ship. I'll wear a long tunic of pale blue cashmere. No high coiffure. Just loose hair, like a Greek goddess. Gavin, we're going to have a party on the battleship tonight. So get out the Chinese lanterns and have them sent down to the harbor. And ask the chef to make a lot of nice big steak pies, 100 of them, and get some rum for the sailors. It is rum they drink, isn't it, Captain? It'll be magnificent, stupendous. Won't I be wonderful, William?
You will.
I'm sorry to be ungallant, Lady Hamilton, but I've just been summoned to weigh anchor and proceed immediately. May I present my son, Midshipman on the Agamemnon?
Oh, such a big son.
My stepson, I should say.
Your wife lives in England, Captain?
Yes, sir, in Norfolk.
And this young man is your chaperone?
Precisely. He keeps a good watch on me. Goodbye, Sir William.
Goodbye, Captain.
Thank you. Goodbye, Lady Hamilton. May I say you've done good service for your country?
Well, it's been rather fun, hasn't it?
Yes.
If ever you're passing Naples again, I hope you'll come and see
us. That'll be delightful.
And next time, there's no need to blow off your cannons. Just knock at the door.
Goodbye.
What was your name?
Nelson.
William, did I seem very silly talking about the party in the moonlight?
Silly? Of course, my dear. But delightfully silly. My Emma at her best.
I wonder. He was so serious. All of a sudden, I began to feel foolish. I don't think a woman can be at her best playing the fool with news of war.
Oh, don't think about it, my dear. Wars are sordid, ugly things. There's no need for them to bother you.
Milady, your dancing master's here. Shall I show him to the dancing room?
No, send him away.
But Emma...
I don't feel like dancing. William, you've left certain gaps in my education. This war, for instance. I know nothing about it.
Yes, but my dear, why do
you... Every time I ask you a serious question, you begin shuffling about. Tell me about it. How did it happen?
It's very dull, my dear.
I don't care how dull it is. I want to know.
Well, here's England.
Such a tiny little bit. Where are we?
Here at Naples.
But why should England fight?
Well, because all through these centuries, she has built up a commonwealth in which every little spot has its purpose and value to the balanced line of life. And there are always men who, for the sake of their insane ambition, want to destroy what other people build. And therefore, this tiny little bit, as you call it, Emma, has to send out its ships again and again to fight those who want to dictate their will to others.
Then came 5 years of war. We fought alone with no allies. The whole of Europe in deadly fear of Napoleon Bonaparte. Nothing between him and the conquest of the world but a few ships. And Nelson.
His Majesty has been pleased to award you the Knighthood of the Bath, and you are promoted to Rear Admiral of the Blue. Sir Horatio, that's wonderful. The men will be delighted.
Oh, yes. We'll catch Bonaparte in a week if we have an extra button on our coattails. 5 years of this war and the gentlemen in London think that men can go on without water or food, that I can fight the enemy without ammunition.
And even His Excellency the Ambassador here sees fit to ignore our plight. What's the matter with the lamp?
It's nearly empty, sir. No more oil on board.
Huh. I'll turn it down. Hardy?
Yes, sir.
Sir Horatio from now on, sir.
Oh, no. Not you, Hardy. Captain always, I hope.
Captain or Sir Horatio, I can't stand this any longer. What's Sir William Hamilton doing? Why don't we sail up to Naples and blow them out of their beds? They'd give us water and meat soon enough then.
You expect me to fire at a neutral port?
Neutral? Neutral against England.
Yes. Things were different when we were here 5 years ago, weren't they?
Our braid was shining in those days. Today, they won't even let us anchor in the harbor, as though we had the plague. They're so scared of Bonaparte, they daren't lift a finger to help the people who still fight him.
Back, starboard!
What a wonderful way to get upstairs. How exciting. Last time on a battleship.
Tonbridge, you scoundrel, what's your news? Did you get anything?
Sir, there is someone here with me.
Our ambassador.
No, sir, Lady Hamilton.
Is there no light? I can't see anything. Everything's so dark. Where's Sir Horatio?
Turn up the lamp just high. And how is Sir William? Ill, I presume. Oh, you must please forgive me if I seem a little abrupt, but we've been living here under great difficulties. We've had no food, no fresh water, no rum, no tobacco. And the Neapolitans have apparently forgotten that they're our allies and that we're fighting for their cause just as well as for our own. And that is why I sent Trowbridge to ask Sir William to remind the king. What is the matter?
Oh. Oh, I'm sorry, yes. You must please excuse these little souvenirs of Calvi and Tenerife.
I had no idea. They told us of your victories, but not of the price you had paid.
Do not distress yourself, please. Tell me your news. Did Sir William see the king?
The king refused to see him.
Refused to see the British ambassador?
I ought to have said he was too terrified to see him. You cannot realize how Naples has changed.
Have they got out of their senses? What do they imagine I'm trying to do? Bonaparte's fleet is in Egypt. For the first time in 5 years, I know where they are. If I can smash them up, I give the whole of Europe a chance to breathe again. And what is more, it's the first time he's been stopped. And yet they will not give me any food or water for my ships.
Well, when I saw that William was wasting his time with the king, I took the liberty of seeing the queen. I've never had such a time in all my life. Even she is terrified of the French. But I got it.
What is that?
A mandate signed and sealed by the queen's own hand. For the full watering and victualling of the British fleet in any port of the Kingdom of Naples. There.
Look out, Bonaparte. By gad, we shall lick you now.
Tell the Queen I kiss her letter. Tell her I hope to have the honor of kissing her hand when we return from our victory. Won't you sit down? You must be tired.
Do you remember the picnic we planned at Capri on your ship? When I was going to dance in the moonlight with my hair down? 5 years ago. Or was it 5 centuries?
When I rudely sailed away.
And now you're going to rudely sail away again. How has it been with you all these years?
Alone, you know.
You've done a great many things. How is your wife?
Oh, she's well enough, I believe.
And when are you going to meet Bonaparte?
Soon, I hope.
You've let him swallow half of Europe.
Now it's Egypt.
Tomorrow it may be India.
We are alone. Don't afraid.
Oh, all the way!
You long to leave, don't you?
Never lose an hour or waste a wind.
Goodbye, Sir Horatio. It's a bit of a mouthful, isn't it?
Yes. Goodbye, Lady Hamilton. You've helped us for the second time.
He didn't lose an hour. He didn't waste a wind. He met his great opponent and he defeated him on the Nile. And when the battle was over, he didn't go back to his country, or to his king, or to his wife. He came back. To me.
Lady.
Send everyone away. A doctor, quickly.
What's come over you, madam? A doctor? Who wants a doctor?
But you staggered out there and nearly fell.
I'm perfectly well. Your Majesty, I'm amazed.
Cosa dici?
I must speak to the King. You must help me, Sir William.
Lui vuole parlare con te.
Va bene. Aspetta qui.
Tell him I didn't come to Naples to be fated. In other times I should be grateful, but today I'm appalled by it. I came here expecting to find an armed camp, and I find this tragic carnival. This battle of the Nile that he's celebrating may have destroyed their fleet, but his army is as strong as ever, and 2 days' march from Naples. Yet the men of Naples dance in the streets with paper caps and toy balloons.
Maestà, Nelson dice che non è venuto a Napoli per...
Qu'est-ce qu'il y a, ma chère?
He says that he has complete confidence in the English and feels sure that they'll do everything that is necessary.
Well, tell him we're not the guardian angels of every country in Europe too lazy to look after itself. You've got to do something, too. At the Battle of the Nile, we cleared them off the seas, but as long as those madmen have their armies on land, no country in Europe is free. They want to get hold of the whole world. If you value your freedom, stir yourselves. Prepare and help drive them off the land.
Ma perché l'ammiraglio così nervoso?
I'm talking of Bonaparte, Your Majesty. Buonaparte! Either advance toward him with sword in hand, or else stay here and be kicked out of your kingdom. Lady Hamilton, may I speak to you? You called for a doctor just now.
I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to upset you. I thought you were ill.
Well, for heaven's sake, where is the doctor?
This is the third time you've helped me. You've been here night and day.
How long?
9 days.
What an enormous bed.
It's my bed.
There's room for 6 people in it.
There may be. I've never tried.
Why am I in your bed?
They couldn't move you to the hospital.
In all that ghastly crowd, you were the only one who knew that I was ill.
Nice cup of beef tea. That'll put some go into him.
Who's there?
It's all right, milord. Just Emma's mother, that's all.
Emma's mother? Do you think I could call her Emma, too?
Why ask me? You've been calling her Emma all this time.
Now, don't say any more. Here you are. There. Now, I'll tell you all the news and all the gossip, too, if you're interested. First item, the King of England is pleased to elevate Sir Horatio Nelson to the peerage. You are now Lord Nelson. Second item, the King of Naples has given you the Dukedom of Bronte. You are now a duke and a baron. Third item, the whole of Europe sings your praises, the victor of the night.
Wouldn't have been possible without you. I'm going to tell them. I'm going to let the whole world know.
I told you not to talk. You've got to rest. In a week, you can get up. And then for another week, you can have nothing but goat's milk.
Disgusting. I shall be able to get up in a day or two.
You can get up when you're told you can get up.
Yes, ma'am. Goat's milk for a week, ma'am, and I get up when I'm told.
That's better. We'll need you now, Lord Nelson. In these times, the whole world needs you. And I need you more than anyone else. As soon as you're well, the king has commanded a gala performance at the opera to be given in your honor. And I want to wear my new dress from London.
Gala performance? Opera? When they ought to be mobilizing armies. They're doomed and don't want to realize it.
You mustn't excite yourself.
Hopeless, I give up. Would you do me a kindness? Write a letter for me, Emma.
Of course. To whom?
Lady Nelson. Burnham Thorpe, Norfolk, England. I wonder what she looks like now. Haven't seen her for 7 years. Wonder why we sailors ever marry.
Do you want that to go in?
Good heavens, no. My dear wife.
My dear wife.
My heartiest greetings from Naples to you and father. I'm in the house of the Hamiltons, and it has taken all their care and kindness to pull me through. I hope someday to have the pleasure of introducing you to Lady Hamilton. Lady Hamilton is one of the very best women in the world, and an honor to her sex.
Mushrooms from Switzerland, pheasants from England, wine from Spain. 120 years old and £5 a bottle. And here sits the hero of the evening, missing it all.
Are you missing it all?
Of course not. The real and exclusive party of the evening is here. Besides, I know exactly what's happening at the palace. The queen. Ferdinando. Taci, taci, Ferdinando. And the king, the poor little king, with 15 children in the kingdom of Naples, and never an answer to give to his queen. And here sits the British ambassador, bored and dreaming only of his last statue from Pompeii. And throughout the evening, there sits Lord Nelson, exhibiting his various moods one by one. Lord Nelson in a bad mood. Lord Nelson in a good mood. Lord Nelson in an exuberant mood.
Am I really such a dull fellow?
Only when you ask questions like that.
And now it's my turn to give you a little presentation. What mood is this? One guess.
Nelson, allowing himself to be just a little bit happy.
Nelson in love.
All the inns in Naples would choose this one.
Probably the last place in Naples where they expected to find me.
Were you at the opera tonight, my dear? No? You should have been. There was quite a profusion of barmaids. Some even found their way to the royal box.
He's drunk.
I see you're not married, my dear. What a pity. Married women are bestowing their favors so cheaply these days.
He's never behaved like this before.
Friends, I give you the real hero of the hour, Sir William Hamilton.
That's an excellent toast, Josiah. May I drink it with you? Thank you. Sir William Hamilton. Lady Hamilton and I are leaving. Fetch a cab.
Sir.
Don't let us disturb you, lads. You're off duty. Enjoy yourself. Forgive them, my dear. They're very, very young.
I have forgiven them.
That's the way people look at these things. They do not believe in a friendship between a man and a woman.
Do you?
Later.
It was magnificent. Stupendous. Wasn't I wonderful, William? Wasn't it a success? A triumph. The greatest ball ever seen in Naples.
You were stupendous. You entertained 200 people as easily as you enchant a solitary husband.
The king said to me, Milady, la sua bellezza mi fa da dimenticare tutti I pensieri della realtà. And Hardy, good old Hardy said, well, I'll be blowed, your ladyship. What I mean to say is, well, you know what I mean. And oh, goodness, I'm so tired.
What did he say?
He who?
He.
Oh, he didn't say anything. He never says much, you know.
People were saying that he should have sat on your right during dinner, not on your left.
What? Give the queen the side with the eye on it? Not likely.
He seemed very happy.
Yes, I really think he's better now. Tonight he seemed to forget everything. His ships, the war, Napoleon, everything.
Could any man think of worldly cares and the spell of Emma's magic? But he deserved his happiness this evening. After such happiness, how sad to find oneself the next morning at sea again. And at war.
But what do you mean? We're going to Pompeii tomorrow.
Lord Nelson will be on his way to Malta.
I think there must be some mistake, William. Lord Nelson left 10 minutes ago and said he would be with us at 12 tomorrow.
The dispatch arrived while dessert was being served, and I had it sent straight aboard his ship. He's probably reading it at this very moment.
Why didn't you tell me this before, William?
But, my dear, I wouldn't have spoilt your evening for anything in the world.
You mean you wouldn't have spoilt yours for anything? You tried to prevent me from saying goodbye to him.
You know, Emma, there are three kinds of deceived husbands in the world. First, there are those who were born to be deceived. Second, who do not know. And third, who do not care. I've been wondering for some time now which of the three I shall be myself.
Have you forgotten the fourth kind, William? The kind that is hard and empty and gives nothing? You married me because you wanted a new ornament for your house, like that painting or that statue or that vase. As far as you're concerned, I'm just as ornamental and just as dead.
But, my dear, how can you call my statues dead? When I'm alone and rather tired, think what it means to me to have my statues with me, to know that they'll always be lovely, will never grow old, and never walk out with sailors. What a pity you're not going to see him again. It would have been a farewell scene of lasting beauty. I shall sleep beautifully tonight. Good night, my dear.
People will see you. They'll talk.
Oh, let them talk. I don't care, do you? Are you sorry?
I'm only sorry for all the wasted years I've been without you. For all the years I shall have to be without you.
You'll come back, won't you?
I wonder if I shall. I feel that I should not. You are married, and I am married. In the magic and music of the ballroom, these things become rather blurred. They stand out very clearly in the dawn. Your life is here. My life is there. We must obey the creeds and codes that we've sworn our lives to. I know that I must not come back. And I know that nothing in this world can keep me away.
Thank you.
first objective is to recover Malta. In that case, I suggest we send the Culloden, the Lion, and the Goliath under Captain Ball to blockade the island and then take possession of it.
Just picked up a fishing boat with refugees from Naples.
Refugees from Naples?
Yes, sir. They say a revolution has broken out. The government got away, but the king and queen are locked up in the palace with most of the court people. I don't understand everything he says, sir, but there must be plenty of shooting, looting, and murdering in the town.
That's what you've always said, sir. Just wait until we've gone. Serves them right. They can't help themselves, nobody else can. Well, this is Lord Keith's order, sir. We've got to meet the Alexander, the Foudroyant, and the Minotaur at the point of intersection here.
Blackwood, go back to your ship. Arrange with Ball to blockade Malta. The rest of the fleet sails to Messina.
Well, what course are you taking, sir?
Back to Naples.
What are you waiting for, Trowbridge? You've got your orders?
Sir, Lord Keith's orders clearly...
Lord Keith's orders are addressed to me. Mine are addressed to you. Is that understood?
Yes, sir.
Return to your ships at once.
May I speak, sir?
Yes?
I'm under your orders, sir. I'll do as I'm told. I'll sail this ship anywhere where there's water under her keel. But I implore you, call Blackwood and Trowbridge back and send the fleet where it's ordered to.
And leave our allies, the king and queen of Naples, at the mercy of that rebel? You know what that mob would do to them. You've forgotten what happened in Paris? You wanted to build that bestial guillotine in Naples?
But you know what they'll say in London, sir? It wasn't the royal family you went back for.
Be careful what you say.
I will say it. They'll say you went back for Lady Hamilton.
Let them say it. Let them say what they wish. I will not see those I love and owe loyalty to left alone.
Back to Naples.
I understand.
In the face of such open disobedience, I must ask your lordships for a clear decision.
Where is Nelson now?
At Palermo, where he took the whole party after he got them away from Naples. Much as I dislike discussing personalities and private matters, I must say he does not behave in a manner befitting a British admiral.
Hear, 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 hear. I quite agree with what you're saying.
Gentlemen, gentlemen, Lord Nelson has some excuse for his disobedience.
How can there be an excuse for disobedience?
He did save the royal family of an allied nation from certain death at the hands of the mob. He also saved the British ambassador and his wife.
What is the point of saving the husband?
Yes, you think it very funny. The whole of England thinks it's funny. The whole of Europe. But it's high time that's up.
Steady, Keith. Steady. No one questions the seriousness of this matter. Lord Nelson is a very gallant sailor, but not even the greatest hero. Strong enough to defeat the prejudices and conventions of society. We must be tolerant with poor Nelson. Be best to bring him home at once. Let him say farewell to this charming little romance of his. Let him forget the beautiful Emma.
Oh, that's appalling.
Wonderful, magnificent. This time we have him at our mercy.
That's the worst hand we've had.
I know. You'd laugh and smile. Just smile.
It's
fortunate they don't understand us.
Possiamo incominciare, signore?
Qual è la posta?
Il doppio.
Il doppio. Benissimo.
But that's madness. We haven't a chance.
We shall in a minute. Smile.
The seven of diamonds.
The ace of diamonds.
There, you see.
The queen of clubs.
But that's madness.
Treble the stakes. Tritichiamo il posto.
Benissimo.
Darling.
The king of spades. The seven of diamonds. And the ace of hearts. Ebbene, signora, cosa ve ne pare?
È molto fortunata lei.
Bravissima, signora.
By catch your impudence, what would you have done if the bluff had failed, eh?
Oh, never mind. I would have fainted and upset the table. And now let us go.
But we can't go yet, darling. We must give them a chance to retrieve their losses.
Oh, they give you a chance? No, come along. I'll order the carriage and we'll drive home by the sea. The air in here is unbearable. I'll be on the balcony. Arrivederci, signore.
Bonsoir,
monsieur.
In a minute.
Emma, there's a matter of some importance that I must speak to you about.
Yes, William?
10 days ago, a dispatch came from the Admiralty instructing Nelson in very definite terms to report in London at once.
What has all this to do with me?
Well, if Nelson ignores this final order, there can be only one result. Dismissal from the Navy and the end of his career. Is it worth it, Emma? His future is in your hands, you know that.
Very well. If we must go back, we must go back. I'll tell him tonight. When do you wish us to leave?
We are not going to leave, Emma. My instructions from the Admiralty say that Nelson is to return alone.
Oh, I understand. The Admiralty is anxious to save him from me. And what am I expected to do?
Well, it'll be very convenient, my dear. The Turkish envoy has invited you to winter in Cairo. Tell Nelson that you love Egypt and that you have accepted the invitation. You can be wonderfully convincing when you try, Emma. And the moment you leave for Egypt, he will have no alternative but to obey orders and return. I know I'm asking you to do a very difficult and painful duty.
Thank you, William.
Well, we both have our duty, haven't we? Good luck with yours, my dear.
Well, I lost everything, but I feel better for it. What is the matter, my dear?
William has just been talking to me, telling me of the repeated dispatches from the Admiralty. He also wanted me to put on a little performance for you. Act one, Emma Hamilton expresses a sudden desire to see the Sphinx and the pyramids. Act two, Lord Nelson pleads, Emma Hamilton remains adamant. Act three, Emma Hamilton departs for Egypt. And Lord Nelson returns to London, a sadder and wiser man. Poor William. He was so serious about it all. I'm convinced he was only thinking of your career. I could see he'd been puzzling through all sorts of stories, and the only one that hadn't occurred to him was the truth. How silly. How utterly silly to think that we should need lies, you and I. What is the truth? Should I have put on that comedy for you?
Might have helped, perhaps.
Oh, no.
I cannot put it off any longer. I must go back this time. They want me to go alone.
Oh, of course you must go. And of course I must go to Egypt. I don't want to be a burden to you, my darling. My darling. And of course, I will enjoy seeing the pyramids and the Sphinx and the Nile, your Nile. Oh, my darling. Why do we always meet just to say goodbye?
With rosy cheeks and eyes.
What are those bells?
Have you forgotten what night this is? The last of 1799. 8 bells for the old year and 8 for the new. Happy New Year, darling.
Happy New Year.
Dawn of a new century.
1800. How strange it sounds.
What a century it's been. Marlborough rode to war, and Washington crossed the Delaware. Louis XVI and Marie Antoinette. The last of the Stuarts. Peter the Great. Voltaire. Clive of India. Bonaparte.
Nelson.
Now I've kissed you through 2 centuries.
1800. The beginning of a new life for me. A life without you. How beautiful was the old century when I was with you.
Emma, say that you could never leave me.
I can never leave you.
Say that you hate the blasted pyramids.
I hate the pyramids.
That you never want to see the Sphinx.
I never want to see the Sphinx.
Will you go back to London together?
I would have died if you'd left me here.
I am Lady Nelson.
Everything has been prepared for your ladyship. Your rooms have been reserved for the Admiralty.
Thank you. Kindly show me to my rooms. You will find our bed linen in the green trunk. We prefer our own sheets.
Very good, your ladyship.
A breakfast precisely at 6:45. India tea with lemon, 1 4-minute egg, 2 slices of thinly buttered toast.
I shall instruct the head waiter, your ladyship.
Oh, I dislike waiters in the rooms. Would you arrange for chambermaid?
As you wish, your ladyship.
Thank you. Here. Go and drink a health to Lord Nelson, my son.
Oh, thank you, sir. I will and be proud to.
I am deeply honored to have you with us on this great occasion, sir. You are the guest of the British Admiralty, Mr. Nelson.
Good. Then charge up a glass of port to the British Admiralty. And let's have it right away.
Yes.
Anything for you, my dear?
No, thank you. 1 small glass of light port for Mr. Nelson and a warming pan for his bed.
Very good, your ladyship.
Wonderful, wonderful. A lap of luxury. No morning service and no chickens to feed. Let's have breakfast in bed with 2 eggs, eh?
I've arranged everything, Father. It's unwise to break good habits even in London. And besides, you must remember Dr. Punsonby's words of advice.
Dr. Punsonby's advice? Did Dr. Punsonby's son ever sink the French fleet? We're going to enjoy ourselves.
Your ladyship. Lord Spencer's here and wishes to be received.
Oh, very well.
Yes.
Good morning, Lady Nelson. The Admiralty appreciates your prompt response to its request. I hope your accommodation is comfortable.
Quite, Lord Spencer, thank you. Pray be seated.
Thank you.
I assume that the Admiralty desires my presence to discuss with them the arrangements for my husband's reception. When does he arrive?
He's already arrived, Lady Nelson.
What?
It was Lord Nelson's special wish that his arrival should not be made public.
Did he include his wife in the term public?
I don't recall the exact phraseology of the letter. However, the Admiralty thought it advisable to accede to his request. He arrived at Great Yarmouth. Yesterday.
I was not aware that Great Yarmouth is a naval port.
He traveled on the mail packet from Hamburg.
Isn't that peculiar? I should have supposed that a victorious admiral would have arrived on his own flagship.
Flagship? It is not customary, as you know, for ladies to travel on battleships.
I see. I wondered why the Admiralty had decided not to give my husband an official reception. Now I understand and fully agree.
The program for Lord Nelson's stay in London will be a simple one. He should be able to leave for his home in Norfolk day after tomorrow, even tomorrow night.
Do I understand that my husband will be forced to resign from the Navy?
Oh, no, Lady Nelson. Hardly as drastic as that. Extended leave for the benefit of his health will be suggested.
A matter of different words. That's what you mean, isn't it? I'm glad. You were quite right to spare the people of London the indignity of fating a hero who treats with contempt the most sacred rules of life.
May I say a personal word? Try to be forgiving, Lady Nelson. Only the weaknesses of the great are glaring.
I prefer the official view.
Goodbye, Lady Nelson.
Did you hear it? Cheering! Listen! He's coming! He's coming! He's coming!
Excuse me, sir. May I have your permission to hang a flag in the balcony?
Hang 2 flags, 3 flags, everything you've got.
Thank you, sir. Come on! Come on! Hang the coat of arms between the flags. Most opportune, sir. We saved the coat of arms from King George's Jubilee.
You realize that these are my private rooms, sir?
You must forgive me, your ladyship. I had no idea this would happen. The Admiralty told me that Lord Nelson's return would be strictly private and without demonstration. We never dreamed that the public would take the matter so completely in hand.
Has the government no control over this vulgar demonstration?
No, ma'am, but the vulgar demonstration has good control over the government.
Bravo for Nelson! Bravo!
I must get back to the Admiralty. Hang out all the flags we've got.
Listen, church bells.
Victory bells for my son.
Mr. Nelson, my name is Hamilton.
Oh, my son's good friend. He's often told me about you in his letters.
You ought to be congratulated. You have a great son. Lady Nelson, I am delighted to meet you. We had the privilege of joining your husband in his triumphant procession across Europe. It was overwhelming and quite exhausting, I'm afraid, for an old man. Oh. But my wife was in her element. She swallows a triumph like a penguin swallows a herring.
Did you have a good crossing, Sir William?
Oh, quite rough, I'm afraid. Everyone was seasick, and I was sicker than them all. I made the mistake of trying to ward it off with pills and mixtures.
Oh, dear.
But what's the good of trying to fight the elements? It's far more sensible, is it not, Lady Nelson? And so much easier to accept their victory, whether those elements be around us or within us. I hope we shall have the pleasure of seeing you frequently, Lady Nelson.
He's coming! Nelson! Nelson! My boy! How proud your mother would be if she could have seen you this day.
How have you been all these years, Father?
First rate. Fanny's taken great care of me.
I'm sure she has. There is so much I have to be grateful to you for. How are you, my dear?
I'm very well.
And how is Burnham Thorpe?
They've named a street after us.
What an honor.
It was magnificent, stupendous, wasn't it wonderful, William? You must make a speech. They're wild with enthusiasm. Come to the balcony, quickly, quickly. Come. Emma Hamilton.
Well, it's been a great day. A wonderful day. And next month, it's the choir boys' picnic at Burnhamthorpe.
Why do you laugh? Are the pleasures of country people of so small account? A little more wholesome, I think, than the mass hysteria we've seen today.
Well, call it what you like. It was a beautiful reception.
You wouldn't believe the fuss they made about him at Naples the day after the battle.
Cool. Such crowds, thousands of Italians, all smelling of different sorts of onions.
Onions?
Yes, they always do. I don't know why. It comes out more and they get excited. There was such a crowd round the embassy that day, the milkman couldn't get in. So his lordship had to go without his macaroni pudding.
His what?
My Emma put him on macaroni pudding to fatten him up after the battle. Did you ever meet the King of Naples, Mrs. Nelson? He was the one for macaroni. He'd take pieces that length, open his gullet and drop it in. Proper caution he was. He came to see Emma with the Queen one day and he pinched me.
He pinched you? The King?
Well, you see, he's a foreigner, poor king. He got so jealous when they cheered his lordship because he loved it so much himself. If you shouted outside his palace, he'd come in and out like a cuckoo clock. Emma, who was that other king we met on the way home? You know, I get so mixed up with all these monarchs. Oh, dear, Emma, will you excuse me, dear? I've been up since 5.
Of course, Mother, darling. Good night.
Oh, it's good to be back in England again, to hear the bow bells and the muffin men and the soot falling down your chimney.
Well, Sir William, how goes the world these days? Can we hope for a little peace now?
Well, I don't know.
What was that medicine you gave my husband?
It's some stuff my mother makes. It's very good for coughs and colds.
I think I would prefer my husband to see a doctor.
This weather is dreadful for him. It was so different in Italy, the sun always seemed to shine there.
Yes, it's never very agreeable in the Thames Valley during the winter. It is only for a few days. Once he's back in Norfolk, he'll be a different man.
Do you think you will be leaving London so soon?
Certainly, there's nothing to detain us. Directly he's made his report to the Admiralty and taken his seat in the House of Lords, we shall be free to go. Why not?
Of course, yes.
What are your plans, Lady Hamilton? I suppose you'll be going abroad again shortly.
Oh, we don't really know. Life is so very uncertain, isn't it?
I haven't found it so. Will you excuse me, Lady Hamilton? It's been a very exhausting day.
Of course. Good night.
Good night.
We've been living in a dream. And now we are faced with the truth. How ugly it is. How terribly ugly.
But we've still got the courage to face it, haven't we?
What's the good of being courageous if you are trapped? If you know you are wrong and that there's no way out?
I'll go to her. And talk to her tonight, at once. And you must talk to William. They must understand.
Divorce?
There is no other way.
No, my love. That might be well enough for other people, but not for you. You are not an ordinary man, and you cannot behave as though you were Mr. Jones or Mr. Thompson.
I wish I were a Mr. Thompson.
Now, for the first time, I begin to understand what William meant. What we are doing is so dreadfully wrong. Of course, I should have realized it before. And because it is wrong, it cannot bring happiness. Those streets we came along today, they're the very same streets I walked through when I was a kitchen maid looking for work. But today they were the scene of your triumph. The triumph of our greatest man coming to his home. They have made you the symbol of all that is most precious to them. And whatever you do will be their guide and example. You will not speak to your wife. And I shall not speak to William. I'm cold. I'm freezing. I'm frightened.
Emma, somebody will hear you. Shh. Emma, dear Emma. Shh.
loud voices, stolen meetings, darkness, suspicion, lies, more lies. Is this what has become of it? All that beauty and light and glory. Good night, my dearest love. Good night.
I, my lords, have in different countries seen much of the miseries of war. I am, therefore, in my inmost soul, a man of peace. Yet I would not, for the sake of any peace, however fortunate, consent to sacrifice one jot of England's honor. Hitherto, there has been nothing greater known on the continent than the faith, the untainted honor, the generous public sympathies, the high diplomatic influence, the commerce, the grandeur, the irresistible power, the unconquerable valor of the British nation.
He's nervous. Look, look at his hand. He's trembling.
It's nerve-wracking for any man to come into the House of Lords for the first time.
It will be more nerve-wracking for the poor man when he goes out.
Why?
There is that Hamilton woman.
Or war. No interest. Separate from
and don't look now. His wife.
And as the nation was pleased with the sincere spirit of peace.
It will be a thrilling moment when he goes into the vestibule. I can hardly wait to see which one he goes to first. Her? Or her?
Yeah, were you comfortable up there?
Sufficiently, Horace, sufficiently.
Did you hear my speech?
For the most part. You have a way of overemphasizing, which is rather embarrassing.
Oh.
But it was interesting, quite interesting.
Lady Keith. Lady Spencer. Lady Hamilton. What was that?
It's Lady Hamilton.
Stand back, gentlemen, please.
Wait, Francis, please.
Will you fetch a gun? Yes, immediately.
Make way, please. What's happened? I told her not to come, sir. She'd not been feeling well all day.
Oh. Where is the doctor?
But why should she faint?
My dear, it's natural to women of all classes.
Drive on. Well?
Francis, how could you drive away like that without making the slightest effort to help Lady Hamilton?
Did you expect me to take that woman into my carriage? Just because she selects the House of Lords as the appropriate stage for her melodrama?
When people have been kind to me and generously, I don't expect you to ignore them when they're ill. Even in the House of Lords.
Generous!
It is well known that what success I may have achieved has been largely due to the help I've received from the Hamiltons. Why are you so ungrateful?
Why are you so blind? Don't you see what that woman is after? It's the oldest story in the world. The most sordid and the most contemptible. Find a public hero, and there you'll find, as sure as fate, a woman parasite. Don't you realize that all she wants is to flutter about in your glory? To use you for her own ambition and conceit? Oh, I know. She helped you. She encouraged you. Why, it was part of her plan to play upon your vanity. And she's quite capable of declaring you the father of her child.
Francis, control yourself!
Why not? Even an accusation of that kind stirs some men's vanity.
Silence!
Oh, yes. Everyone says she's a wonderful actress. She is brilliant to have hidden her sweet secret for so long. The other day you remarked upon the new fashions, all these frills and folds. She invented them, and all society followed. Wonderful to lead society into helping her through an awkward predicament. You fool, don't you realize that everything she does is calculated and cold-blooded? She faints in the House of Lords, a perfect place. Do you suppose she'd have wasted time in fainting in her own bedroom? You poor, silly man.
Poor and silly. Yes, that is what I am without her. I'm a peer of England because of her.
And because of her, I'm Lady Nelson. Lady Nelson. What an honor. They point after my coach, point up at my windows, point at me in the streets. There's a coarse joke about me in the taverns, a foul song about me on the Limehouse barges. Lady Nelson, how funny, how pitiful, and how proud I might have been.
I'm sorry, Frances.
Sorry? Is that all you have to give me?
Yes. That is all.
Very well. I shall take that as your answer. And now you shall have mine. I shall go away, but I shall never drag the name of Nelson through the divorce court. As long as I live, I shall be your wife. Goodbye.
Horatio, call her back. I implore you, call her back. You mustn't let her go like this.
I couldn't help hearing what you said, Horatio.
Please, Father, try to understand.
I do, my boy, I do. I know I'm a silly old man, a humble country parson, and I don't know the world, except the little people who come to me with their little troubles. But even those little people sometimes have to fight in the depths of their soul the same temptations as you, the great of the world. And when they have to choose between right and wrong, I give them the same advice as I give to you now.
Even if it forces all three of us to live in misery for the rest of our lives?
Even so.
That is something I cannot do, Father.
Then I shall go with her, Horatio.
What is the name of the child?
Horatia Thompson.
Her father's name?
Horatio Thompson.
Profession?
A sailor.
Where is he now?
At sea.
Darling, are you well?
Yes, how's the baby?
Oh, I wish you could see her. She's an angel. Not at all like a child of 2 months. She's like a little princess. I wish you could see the way she receives her bottle and then indicates the meal is over. You'd adore her.
What does she weigh now?
9 pounds, 4 ounces before her second bottle. The news, isn't it splendid?
What news?
Well, haven't you heard?
I haven't heard a thing. I haven't been out.
He's done it again. He's beaten the Danes. Oh. It's a glorious victory. You see, Nelson was in the front line of battle, ahead of the main fleet. And when his commander-in-chief saw that the enemy outnumbered us by more than 2 to 1, he sent off a signal to Nelson, telling him to give up the fight and withdraw. And do you know what Nelson did? When the signal was pointed out to him, he picked up a telescope, put it to his blind eye and said, I'm darned if I can see any signal, and went on fighting and won.
There, you see, everything comes in handy now and again if you know how to use it, even a blind eye.
How's William, Mother?
I have some news to Emma. But not so good as yours. All his treasures, pictures, everything. He's waited for them to come from Naples for so long. And now we know for certain they all went down in the ship that was lost in the storm.
Oh, poor William. That was his whole life.
Gavin, that picture there, the Van Dyke. It's crooked, don't you see? I've told you about it twice already. Why don't you put it straight?
I guess so, William. Here, sir.
There. That's good. Good, Gavin. It's good to have my pictures around me once more. And my statues. But they need more light, more room. We must rearrange them, Gavin. Gavin, I'll dine with Miss Hart tonight, alone, at 8 o'clock.
Look after yourself, dear. Talk to Sir William before it's too late, or the house itself will go to his nephew instead of to his wife.
His wife? Why, I've never been his wife, Mother. Let Charles have the money. I don't want it, and I don't deserve it.
But my darling, if things stay as they are, you won't have a penny when he dies. You'll be poor.
I shall be rich. I've got my child, his child. I think that means more than all the money in the world. Can I see Sir William now, Gavin?
I don't think it's advisable, milady. He's sleeping very peacefully.
Victor of Copenhagen. Lord Nelson, your decisive defeat of the Danes has made it possible for the British government to negotiate this honorable and, I must say, unexpected peace with France. We all believe with the deepest conviction that we shall have at last peace.
Lord Spencer, gentlemen, you are celebrating a peace with Napoleon Bonaparte. Peace is a very beautiful word, as long as the impulse of peace is behind it. But gentlemen, you will never make peace with Napoleon. He doesn't mean peace today. He just wants to gain a little time to rearm himself at sea and make new alliances with Italy and Spain, all to one purpose, to destroy our empire. Years ago, I said the same thing at Naples. I begged them, I entreated them not to give way, but they wouldn't listen to me, and they paid the price. That was a little kingdom, miles away in the Mediterranean. But now it is England, our own land. Napoleon can never be master of the world until he has smashed us up. And believe me, gentlemen, he means to be master of the world. You cannot make peace with dictators. You have to destroy them, wipe them out. Gentlemen, I implore you, speak to the Prime Minister before it is too late. Do not ratify this peace.
We appreciate all you say.
Well, thank you, gentlemen. I felt it my duty to tell you of these things. I'm not a statesman, of course. I'm no diplomat. I must leave it in your hands, gentlemen.
Goodbye, Lord.
Goodbye, Lord.
Home in Norfolk, Nelson?
I don't know. I don't think so.
My wife tells me she saw Lady Nelson at Bath recently.
Yes, she's very well. She gives her time to social work.
Ah, and shall you go to Venice?
Why Venice?
Something I heard the other day. Little party to some musical festival. Lady Hamilton, a few English friends.
Where did you hear this?
It was that little musical chap. Came over to Covent Garden to conduct. Heard him say something about Lady Hamilton going back with him. Well, I dare say I've got it all mixed up. Well, it's good to see you home again.
Why, your lordship.
Good afternoon, Mrs. Cadogan.
Sit down, please. Everything is in such a mess.
Why this sudden move from Piccadilly to Nero's Hotel?
Well, you see, everything was so dull and dismal since Sir William died. Emma couldn't stand it any longer.
I see. Where is she now?
Well, she went out quite early with a little foreign musical gentleman. They're driving in the park.
May I wait?
Yes, please. Look at the flowers. Aren't they pretty? So nice for a young widow.
Yes. Horatio. I'm so sorry. Have you been here long?
Oh, no. Emma, dear, I just came in by chance. Your mother has been telling me why you moved from Piccadilly. I think you're quite right.
It was so very gloomy there.
I haven't seen a great deal of you since I've been back, Emma.
Well, you know what it's like. There's so much to do and arrange.
How is the child?
I've been meaning every day this week to go and see her. But it's so difficult. It takes almost a whole day.
Emma, let us drive out and see her this afternoon.
Oh, yes. Lord Nelson, whom the whole of London knows, calling on little Horatia Thompson, whose father no one has as yet seen. My dear, what a titbit for Lady Spencer's next dinner party. Come in. Thank you.
Dear, I know you're very busy and I don't want to intrude upon your affairs. But there are certain things that I don't quite understand since I came back, and to be perfectly honest with you, I don't quite like.
What things do you mean?
Three times this week I have tried to see you, and each time you've had appointments with people whom I don't know and whom I don't wish to know. We had no secrets at one time. Even in our letters.
Oh, you surely do not ask to see all my letters.
Certainly I do not ask to see them, my dear. If you want to hide them from me.
You're jealous.
Why do you make fun of me?
Fun? I've never been so happy in all my life. You're splendid when you're jealous. You must promise me to be jealous always, please.
We were talking about some letters, weren't we?
Horatio, if there are certain letters I would sooner keep to myself, won't you trust me?
What are those letters?
Very well. Read them.
I'm sorry. Forgive me. I'll see you later.
No, Horatio, don't go. You know what will happen if you leave them unopened. We shall never quite understand each other again. They're quite short and to the point. Bills, bills, and more bills. Threats and summonses and lawsuits. I'm up to my neck in them. I'm drowned in them. Why do you think I left Piccadilly? Not because I wanted to. My dear, they threw me out. And why do you think I haven't seen our child for 2 weeks? Because I owe Mrs. Gibson 15 guineas for the rent. Do you think I like going out with that little man from Venice? I hate the sight of him. But I have to do it because he's promised me a contract at his opera house. Yes, I'm going back to work. I've done it before and I can do it again. I don't really mind. You see, Horatio, William didn't leave me a farthing.
Why wasn't I told?
Why should you be told? These are my troubles, not yours. I've never asked anyone for money and I never shall.
Indeed. And are you out of your senses? Now you listen to me and don't answer back. How dare you keep those bills from me? Aren't your worries my worries? Everything I have is yours. Everything. You're going to have a home of your own. And there is going to be no sorrow and no trouble ever again. Emma. Dear Emma.
That's the best drop of rum I've tasted since the old days.
We don't get much excuse to open the bottle lately. You should come here oftener. It warms the cockles of your heart.
Captain Hardy, how nice to see you again. Why didn't you tell us you were coming?
Well, tell you the truth, m'lady, I just happened to be passing and thought I'd come and see you.
Will you stay to luncheon?
Oh, thank you, m'lady.
Mother, darling, tell the coachman we leave at 2. I want to have the child here before dark.
Yes, dear, I'll tell him.
Come along, he's in the garden. You must see his work of art in the summer house.
I don't want to disturb m'lady. I know he likes his peace and quiet.
Why, just because he won't see St. Vincent and Keith when they write him pompous letters? Oh, no, Hardy, you're different. You're an old friend. Come along.
No, to tell you the truth, Lady Hamilton, I didn't come to see him. I came to see you.
Me?
Yes.
Oh,
There's no chance of our being overheard, is it?
Oh, no, but what is the mystery?
Well, do you ever read the newspapers down here?
Not unless we can help it. We're not particularly interested in the court news, nor the gossip or scandal.
Well, then you may have missed what happened. Bonaparte has made himself Emperor of France.
Yes, we saw that. What is his next move?
His next move will be the invasion of England.
Oh, ridiculous.
So it may sound, milady. That's what we all thought when we first heard it. But it's true, this peace was no good. It'll break any day now. This self-styled emperor has made an alliance with Spain. He's raked together a new fleet from goodness knows where, and he's building transports and barges as fast as he can turn them out. From Boulogne to Brest, every single channel port is chock full of them. He's got a whole army behind him waiting to embark. A few weeks from now, all he'll need is a fair wind.
And all you'll need will be Nelson.
Yes, that's it, milady.
Is that all?
That's all, milady. You see, well, Nelson's the only man who can save us.
Now listen to me, Hardy. I have helped the Navy whenever I could, but not this time, Hardy, not this time. Let them find some other man to take command. Keith or Parker or St. Vincent himself, but not him. Don't they understand, Hardy? He's given so much. His arm, his sight, his health. He needs rest and he must have it. For the first time in his life, he's found peace of mind and happiness, and I'm going to see that he keeps it. They want me to use my influence. I will. All my influence to persuade him that this new war is none of his business.
That's all I have to say.
Of course, there's nothing to prevent you from talking it over with him personally at luncheon. Will you stay?
No, thank you, milady. I think perhaps I'd better get back.
Goodbye, Hardy.
I thought you were dressing. What have you been doing? We'll never get there if you don't look sharp. Besides, I'm hungry. Starving.
I don't think we'll go today, Horatio. It will save two trips if we pick her up tomorrow, after you've been to the Admiralty.
The Admiralty?
Hardy has been here. They sent him. They need you, dear, badly. This war is coming as you always said it would. And there's no one else.
Did you tell Hardy I would go?
Yes. It's a matter of course, dear, isn't it?
It'll be freezing tonight on the high roads off the downs.
Yes, I think I'll take the little rug I use in my study.
Oh, yes, I know. I'll get it.
I'll get it, Mother.
Thought he wouldn't need the rug.
He'll never come back, Mother.
is here to add something new to this wonderful year. To honoring all you as free men are slaves, for who are so free as the sons of the waves. Hearts of old are as ships, jolly tars are our men. We always are ready, steady boys, steady. We'll fight and we'll conquer again and again.
Mr. Pascoe, I will now amuse the fleet with a signal. Mr. Pascoe, I wish to say to the fleet, England confides that every man will do his duty. You must be quick, for I have one more to follow, which is for close action.
Your lordship will permit me to substitute expects for confides. It will be sooner completed.
That will do. Make it directly.
You know, those Frenchmen have sharpshooters up in the rigging, sir.
I know. Why do you tell me?
I think it's wise to wear all those decorations and orders. They make a nice target.
I won them in battle, didn't I?
Yes, sir, but...
And I shall wear them in battle.
Every man will do his duty.
Frontier of my lads, 'tis to glory we steer. To add something new to this wonderful year. To honor we call you as free men of slaves. For who are so free as the sons of the waves? Hearts of oak are our ships, jolly tars are our men. We always are ready, steady boys, steady. We'll fight and we'll conquer.
We'll be on them in half an hour, sir.
Capitaine, la flotte ennemie est à 6 000 ouest, nord-ouest à bâbord. L'amiral, la flotte ennemie est à 6 000 ouest, nord-ouest à bâbord.
Préparez pour l'attaque.
Close now, sir.
Not yet. Broadside fire, is it, Ben?
Loaded broadside fire!
Thank you.
You're not badly hurt, are you, sir?
My backbone shot through. You stay on deck, Hardy. Come to me when you can. Cover my face. These decorations. No time for the men to see me like this.
Feeling below my breast. No power. I know what that means, Mr. Beatty. My spine is broken.
Lord, unhappily for our country, nothing can be done for you.
Poor Emma. What will become of her? Is that cheering?
They're cheering in all our ships, my lord. The French line is broken.
Why doesn't Hardy come? He must be killed.
He's on deck, sir. He can't leave.
Cheering again.
The French flagship has surrendered, sir.
Good. Why don't they bring Hardy to me?
He sends a message, sir. We are against the Redoubtable. When we have beaten her, he will come.
Fourteen of them are ours, sir.
Not enough. 20. Don't throw me overboard, Hardy.
No, sir.
You know what to do. Let my dear Lady Hamilton have my hair. And all things belonging to me.
You mustn't die, sir. You mustn't die.
It's all over now, Hardy. All over now.
Sir! Sir! It's 18 now, sir. 18, a great victory.
Thank God. I have done my duty.
Whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die.
It's all right, Anna. I'll draw them myself. Thank you. Come from Portsmouth, Hardy?
No, Spithead, Lady Hamilton. I came on the St. George. She's our fastest ship. Captain Blackwood went ahead to London with the news.
What is the news, Hardy?
It was a great victory, the greatest we've ever known.
It's wonderful.
It was 9 days ago we engaged them off Cape Trafalgar, the combined fleets of France and Spain. They've been destroyed. The oceans are free once more, and England is saved from invasion. The first cannon was fired a little after 12. Within 1 hour, five French ships of the line had struck their flags. His plan was magnificent. He swung our fleet from line of battle into two spearheads that broke the enemy line into three separate parts. Then, about 1:30, I was walking with him on the upper deck. The fighting was at its height. The French flagship, the Redoutable, came through the smoke, and we fought alongside one another. He was so confident. We'd just turned to go back to the... By sunset, everything was over. But he lived to know that he'd won England's greatest victory. His last thoughts were with you, milady. But you should be cared for.
There is no after.